Hello everyone, welcome to Lukman IAS. Today we are going to have the Hindu analysis of 18th November 2020. So let us see which are the important articles in today's The Hindu newspaper. Yes, some important articles from mains perspective and some for prelims perspective. Let us see one by one. First, editorial page. The context of the article is that there is need of bringing changes or reforms in a criminal justice system with respect to the rights of the victim that needed to be ensured. At present, the criminal justice system is more focused on the how to provide justice, or we can say bring the accused to the, let's say, law. So this is how the article is talking about, that the victim participation and their rights is very much important part of criminal justice system, and therefore the Indian criminal justice system should be reformed accordingly. So this is how article talks about some important, let's say, way forward to bring that kind of reforms in this article. So let us see what article is talking about here. Yes, the reforms in victim jurisprudence in criminal justice system. At present, what is happening is engine of our criminal justice system runs full throttle in the name of justice, but on boards only the accused and the functionaries. Here functionaries includes the investigators, we can say the police system, at the same time the judges who deliver the justice, and the accused. The victim is sidelined somehow. The primary victims, mere witnesses in the eyes of the law, are sidelined and left to their own resources. The victims, for no fault of their own, are frequently left without remedy, where the institutions geared towards securing justice to them fail to deliver. Okay, so that's why the article is also talking about the pre-crime, let's say, justice, or we can say, as opposed to post-crime mitigation and rehabilitation. The pre-crime conceptualization of victimization is geared towards prevention of crime. Okay, so in post-crime scenario, however, there is need to shed image of the victim as mere witness and institutionally recognize their rights and requirements. So what are these rights? These important rights are mentioned here. Some very good points that are given in this article. So first, the conceptualization of access to justice for victim requires viewing such access less in terms of DPSPs under 39A. Now this article 39A provides for free legal aid to victims. Okay, so instead of giving more importance to free legal aid, rather that should be let's say considered under fundamental rights of Article 14 and 21. So right to equality, that is Article 41. At the same time, freedom, we can say right to life and personal liberty under Article 21A. So access to justice also requires the creation of victim friendly procedures that are aimed at reducing their inconveniences. Second aspect it is talking about, it is imperative to recognize the need of effective victim participation. Second point it is talking about, the victims are not, let's say, their participation is not there in justice delivery system. Currently the victims and their counsels are entitled to extremely limited participation. Victim impact statements can help accord this right. Victim impact statement that is practiced in other countries, that should be followed in this manner. Third, such legal aid to victims is also imperative for fruition of their right to information. The right to information in turn enables their access to all other rights. So this is also important. Fourth, it is talking about right to information can also go a long way in securing right to protection. So right to protection, right to information, right to participation and access to justice, all these points it is talking about. The victim must be kept abreast of all developments in the trial process which may potentially compromise their security. In terms of like the accused, when it gets let's say bail or come out of jail on parole. So when it comes out of jail on parole, the victim's security, in generally when we talk about the cases related to the assault on women, to hum dekhte hai ki kaise ye accused jo hai baad mein threaten karte hai life ko. Theek hai, so that's why their security is very important. victim security. Fifth, the concept of assistant as envisaged in the 1985 United Nations Declaration on Basic Principles of Justice for Victims of Crime and Abuse of Power needs to be recognized as a right, not merely for victims of rape or acid attack, but for all victims of crime in general. Okay, so concept of assistance. Assistance in terms of medical, psychological, financial and material assistance by the government itself. And sixth, it is talking about right to compensation. Now, this compensation is different than assistance. Assistance is very much required in the immediate part of rehabilitation of victim. Okay. So, in terms of, we can say, psychological, medical, financial and material assistance. And right to compensation, compensation is a long term aspect and therefore recognized to a limited extent under our current laws and is lacking in many respects. And finally, right to restitution must be separated from right to compensation. Here, right to restitution means restitution is generally against the accused, while compensation is generally against the government or state. Okay, so that's why the restitution should be separated from right to compensation. The present justice system largely focuses on restitution part. Jo accused hai unse hi jo hai charges ya fir hum bolte hai compensation le lete hai. The penalty is given to that accused person, and then that amount, somehow the percentage of that amount is given to the victim. However, here the compensation should come from the government also. Okay. In his seminal work, Herbert Packer stressed that criminal justice system focuses on two values, that is of crime control and due process. But in line with Douglas Belloff's addendum to the Packer's model, there is need to introduce the third value also, that is victim participation. Without such value, the aim of justice will be remain unfulfilled, always just a little out of reach. So, yes, very important when we talk about the criminal justice system reforms. So, these points are very important. At the same time, those who are having law optional or public administration optional, for them also this topic is very important. Next, T-cell immunity and COVID-19. Earlier also we discussed how different kinds of immune systems of human being react, response to the COVID-19 infections. Even in ED lectures, editorial discussion lectures, also we talked about this. T cell immunity for COVID-19 is more effective than and long lasting. So some basics about our immune system. We know that our immune system has two types of immune system. First is that the immediate immune system that we talk about is the innate immune system, and second is adaptive immune system. Now, after infection, the first immune system that comes into play is the innate immune system, and when it is not able to tackle that infection, then comes the adaptive immune system. And this adaptive immune system includes antibodies and T cells. Okay, so adaptive immune system has two arms, antibodies and T cell immune system. Antibodies are protein molecules that recognize and bind to viral antigens. However, it is found that the COVID-19 infections with, let's say, mild infections or asymptomatic infections, they do not have that much amount of antibodies to detect, and therefore it is said that the T cell immunity is working among them. Okay, so this is what the article is talking about, T cell immunity. The researchers from Cardiff University have come up with a simplified and rapid T cell immunity test called as T-spot test that can be done in many laboratories. The recent study from Karolinska Institute, there were many surprises. About 25% of blood donors in 2019 prior to the outbreak COVID-19 infection in Sweden had T cell immunity against it, and this increased to 50% after pandemic spread in the country. So, somehow this T cell immunity has increased tackled this COVID-19 infections. This indicates that those exposed to COVID-19 virus, T cell immunity occurs even without detectable antibody response. This is the area wherein we need more research, right? Four coronaviruses causing common cold are widely prevalent in human communities, and two of them are beta coronaviruses, the polygenetic group to which COVID-19 coronavirus belongs. Okay, So obviously this T cell immunity is better and more durable marker than antibodies of the past infections, because antibodies, it is find that coronavirus antibodies, related antibodies are depleting at fast rate after 2 months, and their number is declining. However, this T cell immunity is long term, more than 6 months up to 1 year we have found that, and therefore it is said that ultimately when the vaccine is available, and if it, the vaccine is available in less numbers, then we can say that those people who have this T cell immunity, they are not required with such kind of vaccine, or only one single shot will be sufficient for them. Okay, so this is the significance here of this understanding T cell immunity. Next, find out what happened to missing circus animals during inspection. Delhi High Court has directed Animal Welfare Board of India and Central Zoo Authority that throughout the infection of these zoos, what happened to these animals that were not, we can say, monitored during these infections. So this is what the article is talking about. So what is important for us is basic information regarding these bodies, Animal Welfare Board of India and Central Zoo Authority, which are two important statutory bodies, and therefore it becomes important for our prelims examination, environment section. So what is basics? Both are statutory bodies, but one is set up in 1962, this Animal Welfare Board under Prevention of Cruelty Act 1960s. Srimati Rukmini Devi Arundhale was pioneer in establishment of this Animal Welfare Board of India, and this is the function, main function here is to prevent unnecessary suffering and harm to animals, and such kind of rules are advised to the central government under this act. And Central Zoo Authority, the amendment was made to Wildlife Protection Act in 1991 to establish this Central Zoo to monitor and oversee functioning of and development of zoos in the country, and therefore the function is to provide recognition to zoos, and then let's say acquire and let's say animals for captive breeding in the zoo. So that permission is given by Central Zoo Authority. This is what is done by this statutory body. Okay, so important aspect, headquarters in Chennai of Animal Welfare Board. There are two important environment related statutory bodies having headquarters in Chennai. One is Animal Board, Animal Welfare Board of India, and second is National Biodiversity Authority, NBA, that is also having headquarters in Chennai, and that is the again statutory body that is established under Biodiversity Act 2002. Okay, so this is the information for prelims. Such kind of question we can expect. Animal Welfare Board of India is statutory body set up under Wildlife Protection Act. So this is incorrect statement, not under Wildlife Protection Act, rather under Prevention of Cruelty Against Animals Act 1960. It works to reduce cruelty towards animals. This is correct. It has headquarters located in Chennai. This is correct. So answer is 2 and 3. Next comes, confront sponsors of terror, says Modi. So our Prime Minister addressed BRICS summit, virtual BRICS summit this year, and he emphasized on the cooperation of, let's say, coronavirus vaccine, COVID-19 vaccine development. New development bank of BRICS country would help in financing support research in COVID-19. At the same time, India is in talks with Russia for field trials of Sputnik 5 and expected to begin in Uttar Pradesh. Excuse me. India has led regional collaboration in South Asia for ensuring vaccine access to countries like Bangladesh and Sri Lanka also. Okay. So yes, our Prime Minister also emphasized need of United Nations Security Council reforms, as India will start its 2-year non-permanent membership in United Nations Security Council next year from 1st January. So basics about BRICS. So BRICS is a short form acronym for group of Brazil, Russia, India, China and South Africa. It started as, let's say, first BRICS summit in 2009 in Russia as BRIC countries, and South Africa later joined in 2010, and therefore group was changed to BRICS. Okay, so a leaders summit is convened annually. BRICS nations signed BRICS Contingent Reserve Agreement CRA in 2014 as Fortaleza Declaration, sixth BRICS summit. Okay, so under this contingent reserve arrangement, amount $100 billion US billion dollars was created to provide short-term liquidity support to the members through currency swaps. To at the same time, this new development bank was established as BRICS Bank during this sixth BRICS summit in Fortaleza 2014, and its headquarter is in Shanghai. Okay, so this is basic information regarding BRICS countries or BRICS grouping. Cities need a reset as pandemic exposed frailties. So yes, the article, Prime Minister was addressing Bloomberg New Economic Forum, and during that he stressing that restart would not be possible without reset of mindsets, processes and practices. At the same time, urban development should focus on ensuring better housing, work environment, as well as shorter and efficient travel options for citizens. So urbanization is important topic in our, let's say, GS1 from society and geography perspective. At the same time, it is important from we can say GS3 economy perspective, economic growth and development. Okay, at the same time, referring to government decision to simplify norms for technology and knowledge based tech businesses, said that they would allow people to work from home or anywhere. So that's why the changing nature of working conditions, work from home norm that has spread in urban areas, the new setup, and therefore the kind of changes that we require in terms of change in mindset, processes and practices. This will result into changes in urban setup after this COVID-19. Okay, so COVID-19 and recovery, the urbanization changes in urban development will be looked into in this manner. Okay, so some captions and quotations at last. Yes, the first article, it is talking about the victim jurisprudence, or we can say criminal justice reform, system reform, and second statement about urban development, or we can say post COVID-19 recovery in urban areas. Fine. So yes, these were important articles from mains as well as prelims perspective. Take input for our examination. For further information related to editorial discussion classes or ED classes, wherein in-depth analysis of all mains related articles is done by Ansari sir and team, you can contact Lukman IS. Thank you.